What is up, everybody? Welcome back to another video. Today's video, we are back with another preview slash prediction video. It's been a little bit, actually, since we've done one of these videos. We've kind of just put them into the live streams, but today I'm going to do a video because I'm not going to be here tomorrow to do a preview slash prediction. I'm actually going to be in Indianapolis watching the game from Indianapolis. So I wanted to get something out there as a preview slash prediction. So here we are with another pre-recorded video. So let's get it started. Welcome, ready to the video. Glad you guys are here. And yes, man, we are back with another one of these preview slash predictions. Hopefully this brings like some good luck to us as well. But man, I am fired up about this matchup. I was excited about this matchup coming into the season. I can remember talking about the schedule when the opponents were released, and it was like, oh, this one, if there is a primetime game, this one's got to be primetime. Then we came in here, they're like, no, it's not primetime, but it was to be determined. And then it was flexed, and now it is primetime. The Broncos have been rolling. They've gotten themselves into playoff contention. Us at 9-4, we're in playoff contention. So this is a massive game. It's a standalone game, and I'm super excited for this one. So this is going to be like a condensed version of our normal preview slash prediction videos. Hopefully that's usually always the plan, but it never really happens. But actually, I think this one is going to be like that because it was a shorter week and I spent a lot more time rewatching our game than going through Denver. However, I went through a few of their games, through the All-22, got some notes. Here are my key takeaways and man, what I'm focused on for this game. Plus, we already did our injury reports. We already knocked that out. We can just get right into the preview slash prediction at the end. I'll give you guys a score and we'll see if it hits. Maybe this is the week. It might be. I don't know. We also have our prop bets out right now as well, so if you want to take a look at, okay, I'm thinking these guys are going to have the big game, or me putting together a parlay for this one, definitely go check that out. But let's start here. Let's start with the Lions offensively in this game. This has been a side of the ball that's gotten the most criticism recently, is how the Lions have performed offensively, and it's very understandable. Now, I don't want to make this video in terms of, man, we're going back just to talk about the Lions and how the Lions performed. I don't want to do that. We've done that throughout the week. We've talked about the Lions. I showed you guys the graphic in our last All-22 video about the efficiency on first down and how bad that was, and all of those things are going to be a must. And one thing that we did say is that the blitzing is going nowhere, having the seventh highest blitz rate in the National Football League coming into this game, and that's not going anywhere because you got Minnesota twice, who does it more than anybody else, and then you also have a team like Dallas where it's like, hey, even if they don't blitz, they're still getting a lot of pressure. So with that, this is another team that's going to get after Lions. The good thing is we've had some work against it now, but it's going to be the case in this one, and it's going to be the case for the rest of the regular season. Seemingly, you have to start with their run defense. Now, if you just look at their stats and you're like, man, they're terrible against the run, 5.1 yards per carry, that's last. 144 yards per game, that's last. 28th in expected points added, it's not last, but it's near last. That's terrible. However, I will say this, it's actually gotten much better statistically as this season has gone on. There was a point in time of the season, I know that number was at 5.6 yards per carry. They were getting gashed on the ground. And every time we do our weekly previews, you'd watch Denver and you're like, man, they cannot stop the run. But it's slowly gotten better. And we've seen this defense come along. Obviously, their winning streak has had a lot to do with what this defense has done. And specifically, while the run defense is not elite, it's gotten better. So the numbers look terrible, but it doesn't show the progression unless you know where the stats were earlier in the season. When you look at this defensive front, not a ton of household names necessarily, but on the interior, there is a guy that I really like, and that's DJ Jones. I talked about him back at the trade deadline, and he's really one of those guys I think you have to circle stylistically in this game that the Lions need to find a way to handle, because DJ Jones, he's not always the most consistent player, but he can flash and make big-time plays. He plays with good quickness tied along with the size to handle multiple gaps if necessary. DJ Jones is a big-time piece in their interior. Alongside him, you have a guy like Mike Purcell, who is healthy. He should be playing in this game, their nose tackle. And then, of course, you have a guy like Zach Allen. Now, Zach Allen's tough. He might be their best defensive lineman with his hand in the dirt consistently. He is tough because of some of the lateral movement skills that he brings to the table. He is tough to go at. He's pretty consistent. And then at the edge defender position, they have those guys that we talked about a little bit yesterday. Those guys that you could consider a little bit undersized, but that's because they drop into coverage. They play the run. They're pure outside linebackers. Baron Browning, Jonathan Cooper. Not having Nick Benito is going to be a big loss. But Drew Sanders out of Arkansas, they have kind of the undersized yet very athletic edge defenders that can also play the run. It's actually one of their big strengths at that positional group. And then at linebacker, they got dudes that are fast and flowing, specifically Alex Singleton, and then of course you tie him along with Josie Jewell, who's just kind of like Mr. Consistency on the interior. So that front seven, while you may not have a ton of household names, you got a lot of consistency and you have a lot of pieces that you do like, and you have a really strong rotation. Look at them again, the run defense specifically. This is where a lot of this is going to come down to. It feels like every week we're talking about the run game, but it feels like a lot lot's going to come down to how well the Lions run versus how well they stop the run in this game. And the reason I say that is because his back end is legit. They're very talented in the back end, and we know they like to blitz. So that run game, keeping the Lions on schedule specifically, we saw the LA Chargers. I didn't think they did a great job of staying on schedule at all. The Lions are going to want to do that. And we saw it, Chicago, very good run defense. Lions ran the ball well. But in the second half, to play off of all the run plays, they started to try to pass the football. And not to say they were bad designs, the Lions just did not execute. They fell behind the chains, and things got ugly. In this game, I circle a similar thing. We have to find consistency rushing the football. And I think the Lions will find consistency rushing the football in this game. So with some of the inside rushing attack, I actually think this is an excellent opportunity for David Montgomery to be extremely successful. Why? I think stylistically, he just makes sense for this game. Number one, I think the Lions are going to get consistent movement on the interior, regardless of who's out there. Now, DJ Jones is the guy that I circle and say, okay, this guy can give some problems because he can be a little bit tough to double team on some of the outside zone runs. But then also Mike Purcell, he's got really good size in the inside as well, and he kind of becomes the key on some of the A-gap runs. However, I do think the Lions, for a majority of the game, will be able to move defensive line, especially if they're starting five. Essentially, the starting five is actually playing in this game. I think they're going to get a good movement. So I look at a guy like Montgomery because of how fast flowing these linebackers are, whether it's inside or outside zone rushing. This is a team where I think the ability to press the line of scrimmage, press your gap, and bounce off of that is massive. Why? Their linebacker play. Guys like Alex Singleton are extremely aggressive, in my opinion, but they're also decisive. They're going to see the development, and they're going to dive. They're going to have that play recognition, read the blocking scheme, and they're going to go make a play. The thing about that is while they can kind of shut down and limit some of those run plays, even if their defensive line gets moved. The thing is, though, if you have a running back that's disciplined and is willing to press, and then open up other gaps, which Dave Montgomery does a really good job of, I think you can get consistent 5-yard, 4-yard, 3-yard, 4-yard, 5-yard chunks over and over and over. I think that can be there in this game because I anticipate the Lions will be able to move this defensive line. And at very worst, they'll start forcing them to put extra bodies in the box. So I think Montgomery makes a lot of sense for consistency. However, there is definitely a part of me that says Jahmyr Gibbs will get some good touches because of how well he's played. And it's like when you look at Montgomery, the skill set makes sense. But when you watch Gibbs and what he's been these last couple weeks with the ball in his hands, he's looked really darn good. I mean, he has taken off with the ball in his hands. Now, I like him specifically more, of course, on some of the outside zone rushing attack because of the aggressiveness of these backers to get to the edge and make these cornerbacks tackle one-on-one. I think that's an area where Pat Surtain, they have guys that can tackle Moreau. These guys will tackle and play the run, so it's not like they're weak there. But it usually is an advantage when you're back and get one-on-one with a cornerback. Usually that's the case. So I do like Montgomery to have a couple of opportunities to bounce out some plays, get off schedule, pick up some chunks. But I think Montgomery does make a ton of sense stylistically in this game, and it would not shock me if he got a lot of carries. Gibbs has shown us so much where you're going to rotate both of them. I mean, they're probably going to get pretty good amount of split carries in this game, and that's a really good thing for the Lions. Now, in terms of pulling offensive linemen, the power rushing attack, this is something I saw Houston did a lot more. I don't know that the Lions will lean into this. I don't think they necessarily need to. A position that I'm specifically very intrigued by in this game rushing the football is our fullback, who will probably be Sam Laporta, could be Malcolm Rodriguez. We'll see if the Lions try to utilize that. If they do, versus these edge defenders. Again, kind of your undersized outside linebackers. They're not like your Khalil Mack they're rolling up against, but at the same time, they do a lot for a lot of the outside rushing attack, for a lot of the power run plays. You know, you want to kick out, pick those guys up. Those guys are tough at the point of attack. So that matchup in particular, I think Sam Laporta has done a really nice job with us. I love that matchup on paper and just seeing how that plays out. But I do think the Lions can lean into some of that zone rushing. And one little thing I will kind of throw out here just because I think it's interesting, it's keep an eye on an occasional draw play, especially from Gibbs. We know we like to put him out there on passing downs, but if he's not going to stand in a pass protect, if the Lions get caught behind the chains, maybe it's a holding call or something on first down or second and long. Keep an eye on the Lions trying to utilize a draw. We don't see that a ton, but this is a defense that, again, I think is decisive in the second level. And because of that, even in the back end, you can get them to drop pretty aggressively. And I think you can try to get some chunks out of some of those underneath plays, specifically with like a draw little look they could do to Gibbs. Just something to keep an eye on. Now, passing the football, this is where things get real interesting because statistically, they're not great here. 27th in pass rating allowed, 24th in completion percentage, 24th in yards per game. None of those numbers look very good. However, I think they're pretty strong in the back end in terms of just personnel across the board. They don't have a ton of spots where I say, oh, they're weak here. PJ Locke at safety, he's not a bad safety. Now, you can get some breakdowns, but he's not a bad safety. If Justin Simmons is like, man, he's having the worst year of our defensive backs, you're in a pretty good position. At cornerback, they're strong. With Pat Surtain on the field and Moreau opposite of Pat Surtain, you throw in the slot McMillian and what he's done this season, this is a pretty well-rounded group tied along with the linebacker that play that they're getting underneath. And they are able to throw a lot of coverages at you. They're not not one team that kind of lives in this is what we are. You throw a multitude of different coverage looks at you defensively, which can make it really difficult, I think, to pick up on consistent tendencies and how you want to attack them over and over and over. With that being said, though, I'm really curious because I think this is a game with real opportunity for the middle of the field to be opened up. And we've seen trouble when we haven't been able to do that. I think a big positive is being at home. If the Lions can get some one-on-ones, wouldn't be shocked if they try to get a shot to kind of open up the jar a little bit. Like, hey, man, we're capable of this. Let's just do it. Especially if you come into this game and Denver, who runs a lot of different coverage, says we're going cover three over and over and over and over. And the Lions just say, you know what? Let's just get one-on-one on the outside. Just let somebody try to win.
And even in a look like this, they're trying to keep a safety on top of the corner here, run a cover six look. And you can see there's some pressure, but with Stroud's eyes going opposite on this play, you can see the safety kind of helps across the field. But he can't do that because he has the route over top here. So with an in-breaking cut early, they're able to break back outside, get on top of the corner, and then the safety is not there to help over top. So you'll get occasional breakdowns from their back end where it's either a loss at the line of scrimmage or things like this.
Denver came in with that specific game plan because to me, if I'm playing the Lions, I'm focused on take away the middle of the field, aggressively take away the middle of the field. At the same time, extra attention if I'm playing man is probably going to St. Brown. But with that, just based on what I've seen, I think this is a team that you can attack kind of that level one, level two, middle of the field. Tight end position, Laporta. Been a little bit quiet these last couple weeks. Statistically, this makes sense for a game to get him going. Against man, I don't think their safety position is great straight up in coverage, so I love that matchup. But also the middle of the field, they pass off everything. So you have a really good opportunity to get some of those routes where you kind of just spot up, you roll through and sit down in coverage. Just like you think about the LA Chargers game, spot up in coverage, find some of those little underneath shots, keep us on top of the chains in some of the middle of field attacking area. Look at this cornerback position, you look at what they have in the back end. I do think maybe their weakest spot could be arguably their slot corner in McMillian in terms of just matching up one-on-one. It's really not a weakness here outside of like a guy like Mathis stepping in. They're pretty strong across the board. However, I think when you focus on some of the more situational spots, one thing that I'll keep an eye on, Lions get into the red zone, keep an eye on the Lions trying to put a guy like Peoples Jones into the slot. We've seen them utilize him now, putting a guy like that into the slot, trying to get a bigger piece on some of these smaller cornerbacks, let him be utilized in some of the one-on-one because they will play some of that man coverage when you get into some of the tight area. It's Khalif Raymond. I know he hasn't really popped, and a lot of that is who we have personnel-wise now. Maybe it's Jamison Williams, but man, I love the idea of trying to get one of those guys a shot play from the slot, mainly because, well, really two things. One, you can. First off, we've seen breakdowns from them in the back end, but then also the aspect of their slot corner one-on-one. He's not great with vertical speed, so whether that's Khalif Raymond, or maybe you try to put the big guy Jamison Williams in the slot and you try to get him a shot. I think if we're going to get a shot on the outside, if they're sitting in cover three, makes sense. But I do like an idea of one of those guys getting a matchup there that they like and being able to try to attack that. I also would not be shocked if the Lions came out and did some empty look to just to get the ball out of their hands quickly. One thing that worries me in this one is a lot of the play action bootlegs, play action rollouts. Why? Because this defense is aggressive. They're going to try to, they smell blood, man. When they get you in a position where first down's not super successful, they want to then get you behind and change on third and long. They are one of the best third down defenses in football. I think they allow like 32% conversion percentage. Big part of that is also they're going to force you into third and long. And a big reason of that is if they're successful on first down, that second down play, they're not afraid to bring heat. They're not afraid to blitz to stop the run or the play action and create negatives that way. I thought Houston had a lot of trouble with it, and they're so athletic on the outside that if you're trying to boot a guy like Goff out and they pick up on it and they don't completely crash, I don't think a lot of good things are going to happen with that. And they communicate pretty well in the second level. So to me, maybe Ben Johnson has something for that where he's like, oh, I'm going to do this and get them to overplay it. Maybe you try to get a lead blocker in front, or maybe you get kind of like a half roll and then you try to get a shot back the other side, maybe like a leak to the tight end, maybe something along those lines to try to overplay it and get a shot out of it. So to me, the tight end position, Laporta, wouldn't be shocked if he got going a little bit, especially if they do play cover three. Look for the corners of the field, middle of the field. Also St. Brown, if they're playing especially more man coverage, wouldn't surprise me if the Lions try to put St. Brown on the outside, get some matchups with a guy like Moreau. I'm assuming we're going to see a lot of Pat Surtain if Josh Reynolds plays on Josh Reynolds. Now, I do think that as good as Pat Surtain is, he can get beat at the top of the route. And I think Josh Reynolds, that's where he's at his best. I think he can win there. So even if that's the matchup, I could still see him be capable of picking up a couple receptions and not being completely shut out of the game. If they don't want to go there, I understand it, but I could see him being capable of having some success. But a guy like Moreau, who I think can struggle a little bit at the top of the route, being able to stick and maintain at the top of the route, he's got good quickness, he's got good speed, so maybe that's not just like the perfect matchup for a guy like Jamison Williams to be consistently successful. It could be, but a guy like Donovan Peoples-Jones, a guy like St. Brown, if they can get that on the one-on-one on the outside, try to get creative and try to find those matchups a little bit, maybe even a Sam Laporta like they love to do as well, and then try to get some speed in the slot and see if they could take advantage or pull these safeties out of the play at very least. And then again, if they're playing cover one or playing single high, I expect the Lions early in this game to try to get over top. They're going to try to take a shot one-on-one if they're going to get that look over and over, just to kind of open up like the bag of like, okay, this hasn't been there. It's going to be there today. We're going to at least threaten that immediately. In terms of pressure, really the only guy that I circle here that's a big concern on early downs, first, second down, without bringing a blitz, Zach Allen on the interior. He's a guy that can win specifically. However, especially with a healthy offensive line, I really like our matchup here. I understand that they have not a bad pressure rate. It's like 19%. It's below average. However, they blitz over 30% of the time, so their blitz rate's much higher than their pressure percentage. I don't think they get a lot of natural pressure with four. I think the Lions will win that matchup. I do. Then it's just about getting guys open in coverage. However, it's the blitzing that's concerning. Not because they blitz a lot. I believe the Lions can handle that. They've shown that over the last few years. But it's where it comes from because you don't know, especially in third down. Slot blitzing is a huge aspect of this defense, McMillian, and then also the linebacker blitzing. They can get a lot of free rushers, and again, because of their flexibility at that edge position, those guys can easily drop out into coverage. So you don't really know where it's coming from. So that running back in pass pro, especially for play action sets, he's going to have to be on it, because Singleton will literally just jump play actions and just try to get the quarterback down before he even can flip his head around. So they're going to have to be massive, or when you spread them out, if you get the third and long, it could come from everywhere. So you might get some spots where you end up max protecting and all of a sudden guys drop out. But my initial thing would be protect the quarterback, leave extra guys in if we have to, have them leak out late on the play. This is why you don't want to get the third and long on this team, but they are very exotic in the ways that they blitz, and that's what makes them difficult. Not that they get pure pressure. If they're bringing a four-man rush, I trust us to handle business. It's when they start to get out of that, and here comes Baron Browning. Oh no, here, this guy's dropping out. Here comes the slot, and you don't even know where it's coming from. That's where they get dangerous to me. But around to the other side of the ball, one thing that I've loved about Denver this season is I think they have a very underrated offensive line. Like, they don't have a lot of weak spots, and it's one thing when we do these weekly picks, I look at Denver, and I'm just like, man, I really like their offensive line. From Bulls to Powers to Cushenberry to Quinn Meinerts, I think that's how you say his name, and then all the way to McGlinchey at right tackle. They're pretty well-rounded. They don't have a lot of weaknesses. Now, I do think pressure-wise, their interior is kind of their weakest spot, specifically their two guards. That's where you can kind of win, whether that's Levi. Maybe he gives us some flashes there. Maybe the Lions try to get John and Josh Pascal into some of those matchups, especially on pass downs. And also, the right tackle can be had, but they don't have any, like, true glaring weaknesses outside of the guards. I think you can get some wins on early downs. But as a run-blocking unit, they're very good. Rushing this season, 4.3 yards per carry. They're 11th, a 13th in yards per game, and also 13th in expected points added. And then they have this little aspect of Russell Wilson's not like a design runner over and over, but he's got kind of that like Jordan Love, what he did to us to seal the game. If you continue to crash down off the edge, he's going to hit you with a zone read. And it's difficult because it's not like Justin Fields where he handled it well, but you're expecting it. It's like no one's expecting it because he'll consistently hand it off. And then when you stop suspecting it, all of a sudden he takes off with it and he picks up a first down. He may not score a touchdown. He's not that dynamic, but he'll pick up a first down. So you always have to stay disciplined on the backside against this team, because not only is there the threat of Russell Wilson, there's also the threat of McLaughlin can get to the edge. Javonte Williams, good vision. He likes to bounce as well. The backside contain is so key in this game, not just from linebacker, but specifically defensive end to me. Josh Pascal, John Kaminsky, Aiden Hutchinson, those guys on the backside being discipline to make sure that those things don't pop back up outside. But the matchup is this. It's that offensive line, specifically the interior, against our defensive tackles. It's Benito Jones if he plays. Isaiah Bugs, both those guys played pretty well against Chicago, but to me, this is a different type of matchup. It's Levi if he's in there. These are guys that get real movement on the interior, and there's certain games where you're like, man, they're just moving people off the ball. They like to utilize a fullback, and optimistic me is that, hey, Jack Campbell last week looked pretty good. He's getting better at that. The way he's reading and reacting, he's flying to the football, man, he's been on point. But safety run support, cornerback run support, specifically Brian Branch, those guys become massive once again, just like we saw last week, because it's not just about the linebacker, it's about the secondary getting involved as well. They do try to get the edge. Specifically, you'll see the toss plays with McLaughlin. Again, I circle those defensive ends, being able to force them to at least spread it out a little bit, bounce, allow the linebackers to really have a chance to get into the play. And is everything in this one, even from the linebacker position, Alex, Jack Campbell, if one guy gets to the edge, the other guy's got to be able to maintain that inside cutback lane, because that's where they get you, is they have really good running back play, and I think with a good offensive line, which can get you to kind of overplay a little bit. But that's the matchup to me. It's how do these interior guys specifically handle dealing with Cushenberry, Powers, and Quinn Meinerts, a very good run blocker. How do they deal with that? If they handle business and we walk back, we're like, hey, we kind of won in the trenches, I think we'll be absolutely fine. Their offense is going to struggle. But if they're getting movement, now that's how they want to play offensively. I wouldn't even be shocked if the Lions said we want to bring a little bit of pressure to try to get them behind the chains, set up one of those play action shots that they love to do off the run, or on second down, maybe first down, the Lions say, you know what, we're going to bring the linebacker on this play. Don't be shocked if Aaron Glenn, we know he likes to bring heat. Don't be shocked if he does that on a few early downs, trying to jump them behind the chains, put them in third and long, because here's what we know. In their passing attack, I'm going to get to this in a second, Every time they're behind the chain specifically, they always seem to run screens. So to me, they're kind of predictable in that sense. Their passing attack is not super dynamic. It's shot plays on early downs. It's behind the chains. We're going to throw a screen. And then on top of that, it's like, hey, if we're going underneath, it's Russell Wilson's ability to get the ball out because he has that athleticism to just stay on his feet and find somebody. But he's going to hold the ball for a long time. Of course, on those, you know, third downs, those pass downs, don't look out for some of the run plays because they're one of these teams that are not afraid to hand the ball off on third and five, third and eight. And then, you know, Sean Payton's background, he'll go for. It's the shot plays on early downs. So I think the Lions have a couple ways to approach this. Do they try to get aggressive or do they try to sit back and say, hey, man, we don't want to give you those shot plays, right? They try to make you work long drives or are they going to try to create negatives and back you up? Maybe it's got to be a mix of both, but I think there's really those two ways to kind of go at this team. And for a team like Houston, quarters coverage, right? Cover four. We don't want to give up the shot play and they're going to try to get them regardless. Now, what that does is they have a very good ability and it takes a little bit sometimes, but once they kind of pick up on what you're trying to do, they have an ability to create guys open. Like this, you see the motion, they create an open receiver, they get a one-on-one with leverage, and it's Cortland Sutton. He's kind of like their shot piece. They also have Jerry Jeudy, obviously Mims double moves. He's a problem if he gets isolated one-on-one. So they got a lot of guys that can get over top, but you can play like that.
Now, what's dangerous about playing that quarters coverage is, of course, you can kind of isolate one-on-ones across the board, especially if you go vertical routes. It just then comes down to you're playing one-on-one, but you have a little bit of off coverage here. You can see defensively they go into a cover six look, so you kind of bracket in. Maybe they're deep threat over top. You play quarters opposite. I think the two high safety is what you want to do, but then again, it comes back to that defensive tackles can't be consistently getting moved back. You have to have some efficiency stopping the run. Otherwise, it's difficult to do this.
Test your backers. If they can't get those shots, they're going to go right at your linebackers. They're going to try to test them, communication. They're going to run the same little crossing routes that a lot of teams do. And last week, the positive is our linebackers were much better in that. But Alex, Jack Campbell, those two guys, they have to be on the same page. But it was better last week, much better than what we've seen a lot this season. Those guys are going to be tested, as well as, you know, some of the drag play action, the jet sweep looks as well if they know that you're playing back. So that's another thing, right? They're going to try to attack kind of that second level of your defense if they know you're sitting in quarters. In this year, Russell Wilson has been very willing to take those underneath zone hitters if it's by design. If it's play action shot, he's trying to take the shot. But if it's like a little zone playing or sitting in zone and they're set to just take everything underneath, he'll take those underneath passes. His completion percentage is high and he does a good job of just extending and somehow getting the ball out and still going forward. So that's where that balance has to come in between bringing pressure and not bringing pressure. It's gonna be a tough one for Glenn, but I look forward to seeing how it goes. You get them in the short yard situations, you have to watch for the ball is going right behind that right guard. Quinn Meinert is exactly where that ball is going on QB sneaks, fullback dives. If it's third and one, fourth and one, it's going behind that guy. So just anticipate that. Everything goes behind that guy. They try to get the movement right behind him. Then on third downs, I circle a guy like Jerry Jeudy. Cortland Sutton's the shot guy. Jerry Judy's the guy that can go win one-on-one because he's a nice route runner. He's kind of the guy that I circle in those spots. Everybody else, it feels kind of hit and miss the results they get, whether that's going to Mims underneath or their tight ends underneath. You kind of feel like you get like, I don't know how that really went. However, it's Jeudy on third down I focus, and it's Cortland Sutton's ability to get over top. Everybody else can kind of get involved over top as well.
Clearly enough, one of the best matchups in this game is going to be Cam Sutton and Cortland Sutton, Jerry Jeudy and Jerry Jacobs. It's kind of weird how the names match up there, but those guys being one-on-one to the outside, just being able to protect over top is the key. But like this, if they sink you in quarters coverage, they're going to get these guys in the mix. And as well as I thought we communicated last week, this is where we have had struggled this season, redirecting, being able to follow these shallow crosses underneath. However, the flip to this as well is also the edge defender. And you see how he crashes on the backside? This comes back to the discipline point. They all work in unison here, because here when he crashes on the backside, now all of a sudden Russell Wilson has a clean path to just get this pass off. But we've also seen other examples where when you're disciplined on this backside, now you get in his face, you help take these away for the backers, and then all of a sudden everything kind of work a little bit better. So discipline is key. You can say the same thing over Terp. Craig Kirby, we can't be biting on everything, because trust me, they're going to try to take advantage of that. And I love Kirby. He's played great last week, but he will bite. So we have to be disciplined every facet defensively to not give up the game-breaking play, which is what I feel like they're looking for every time I watch them. They don't want 5 yard, 5 yard. They want 60 yard, change the game.
The guard position, I think, is where you can get it. I wouldn't be surprised if we tried to do it a little bit on early downs, but I also think for the Lions in this one, I wouldn't be shocked either if they said we want to drop back, especially on third downs. They don't want to give him a free look, allow Russell Wilson to extend a play with losing a guy in coverage. If you can get them into third and medium plus, just bringing four would not be, I don't think, the biggest problem in this game. Let him take everything underneath. Let him take a screen. Let him check it down. Rally and make a tackle, right? Don't do anything crazy. Early downs make sense. I don't know that I'd be doing as much on pass downs, but we'll see how that balance looks, because I don't think you ever know with Aaron Glenn. I'm very curious to see how he attacks this team, because he's going to be in for a big challenge. Last time we saw this Denver team, we lost 38-10, but that was a few years ago. A lot of things look different, but Khalif had 4 receptions for 31 yards. That's why I think Khalif could be interesting. Speed in the slot could be interesting. The tight end position, we saw the Chargers have success there. I think you get matchups, especially if they're trying to lean man on the safety. It's one of the best, I think, matchups singled up in this game. Or really, if you can get a tight end on a guy that's not Pat Surtain, which in a lot of cases will probably be their number two cornerback if he's put out wide. But I assume a lot of attention is probably going to go to St. Brown from the safety position, and that's where they could take away the middle of the field is shots over the middle of the field. So I do think that other guys are going to have to find a way to win on third down, where I expect them to throw some attention to St. Brown. Then we have to see who else can win in those spots. But don't be afraid to use People Jones. Don't be afraid to use Laporte on the outside. St. Brown, get him on the outside as well. I won't be surprised to see any of those things the Lions try to do. But I think Laporte is more productive in this game, and I think the Lions will be able to run the football. That to me will be the difference in this one. Always comes back to the turnover battle, so staying on top of the chains will help you in that aspect as well. Gotta cut out those mistakes pre-snap. On top of that, and playing indoors, I expect Goff to be better in this game passing the football. So with that being said, I'm gonna go with a score prediction that feels very high. It's a lot of points score against a really good defense, and I don't want to make this sound like I'm disrespecting this defense. This defense is legit. So I'm worried about this one a little bit, but it sounded good when I said it in a round table, and I kind of like it. I'm going 30-20, Lions win this football game. I think they get rolling early in this game. They force a couple sacks, maybe get Russell Wilson behind the chains, and they're able to build up a lead and kind of play their way in this game. And I think that's going to be the key, and I think Dan Gamble gets the game ball afterwards for beating Sean Payton. So I'm going to go 30-20. Don't be surprised if he pulls out some kind of trickery, especially on offense. Maybe we get a shot play, something like that. We haven't had one in a while. Safeties can break down a little bit. So 30-20, Lions win, get to 10-4. That's my prediction. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Thank you, Prep, for watching, and I'm out.